Valley State University. I'm Dr. Helen Marley, and I'm so happy to welcome you to our 20th 21st century piano lecture recital. I'm really excited that six pianists will be talking about six different composers from six different countries. Is that awesome or what? Wow! So you will hear some very interesting information about each of these composers that the pianists have chosen, and then you'll hear a special piece that was written by these composers. So please enjoy, everyone, because it's going to be really different and exciting to watch. And this first person, can you tell where this person's from with a name like this? Ooh, do I have any ideas here? Oh, yes. Did you think of anybody anywhere else, Noah? You were going to say Italy, too? And are they right, Rachel?
Yes.
Let's welcome Rachel.
Here, so I'm going to do my presentation on Luca Vito Einaudi. He's an Italian pianist and composer who's still living today. And I chose him because there was one particular piece that I've always admired of his, but of course I couldn't find the sheet music for it. So we'll go with something different. But next slide. So Luca Vito Einaudi, he was born in Turin, Italy on November 23, 1955. His father was a publisher, and his paternal grandfather was actually the president of Italy from 1948 to 1955, coming out of World War II. That's a stressful job. Luca Vito's mom played piano for him as a child, so helped to plant that seed of love for music. And his maternal grandfather was a composer, a pianist, and an opera conductor. And he actually wrote an opera that was on its way from Australia to Rome for a commission when it was bombed and sank during World War II. But he happened to remember the score, and so he was able to put it back to paper and send it off to Rome to be commissioned. So Luca Vito studied at the Conservatory of Turin and the Conservatorio Verdi in Milan with Luciano Berio. That was his mentor at the Conservatorio. And Luciano Berio, he was known as being an avant-garde composer, which means that he liked to experiment with new and unusual things. So Luca Vito's early life and career, he began composing music using a guitar, a folk guitar, as a teenager. And then he won a scholarship to the Tanglewood Music Festival in Massachusetts, and that's where he was exposed to American minimalism. So has anybody heard of minimalism? Because, you know, I didn't know it until last semester when Dr. Marley taught me what it was. Has anybody heard of Philip Glass? Has heard his music? It sounds a little different, right? It sounds a little different. You know, if you were to listen to a Mozart or a Beethoven, you know, sonata, that's pretty predictable. There's a form to it. You know what to expect. Philip Glass describes minimalism as, you know, it's not necessarily rewriting a language, but we're changing how we hear the language. You know, what you hear depends on how you focus your ear. So what you might hear in minimalistic music, you might hear short phrases that are repeated. You know, you'll hear that in a piece that I'm going to play today, you know, some broken arpeggios. I'm not truly changing much in my right hand, but the harmony is changing in the left. So you'll hear some harmonies that sound consonant, right? They sound pleasing to the ear with some, you know, expeditiously placed dissonant harmonies. Harmonies that sound a little odd or might, you know, out of place. Phasing is present in minimalist music. This is where you'll hear a short motif or set of notes that start at different times. I don't do that really in this piece. You might hear use of drones. Has anybody heard a bagpipe? Yeah, and what they kick off, you know, the right at the very, very beginning. Just a long, unchanging note. That's what a drone is. And then you might hear, too, you know, with minimalistic music, composers may use kind of traditional classical instruments like a piano or a violin, a cello, but then they might also, you know, add more modern instruments, say a saxophone, which was invented in 1841, or maybe use of technology with a looping track behind it. So Luca Vito started his career, he collaborated on some ballets. He wrote some pieces for orchestra and ensemble. Those were performed in Italy, France, and the United States. Some of his early albums, Stanza, that was written in 1992, and Einaudi describes that as a journey towards essentiality, trying to achieve the maximum expressive intensity using the minimum dispensable. So minimalism, how few notes can I use and create the maximum expression? And then Le Onde, that was an album that he wrote in 1996, that means the waves, and that was his first solo album, and that really opened the door for him in the piano world. So he's also known for his work on soundtracks. He wrote the score for Dr. Zhivago Remake, The Untouchables, Aquario, and the Black Swan trailer. So he's won numerous awards for Best Film Score. He's performed live concerts in Paris, Italy, United States. So a couple of his albums, Una Mattina and Divinaire. Not sure I'm pronouncing that one right. What's neat about those two albums is that he got top classical album in the classical charts, but it also crossed over into the pop charts. So now we have a composer who's now bridging two different genres with the same album. And he was the only classical musician to play at the first iTunes Festival. So that's pretty cool. And that really kicked off his extended world tour. So he conducted an orchestra. He did compose an album in a time lapse that was recorded in a monastery. And that, in true minimalistic fashion, had piano, strings, percussion, and electronic tracks. His album Elements, that sold out in pop arenas and classical concert halls. And here's where we see another theme of Einaudi, is this kind of marriage between nature and music, right? Elements was inspired by air, earth, water, and fire, and this really was a tribute to his mentor. In 2021, he performed 11 concerts at natural venues that can only be reached by foot. So you think natural parks, a mountain meadow, a creek, a nature reserve. I suppose if you're a composer as well-known as he is, you can hire somebody to bring a piano anywhere. these concerts were held at dusk, dawn, or under the stars. So that would have been really cool to go see, I think. His album Underwater in 2022, that again, this merging between nature and music, there's a sense of fluidity, of intimacy with the piano. And then the piece Experience, he composed that in 2019, and that was my inspiration for choosing him as a composer. This was originally written for a soundtrack, but it really became a piece of its own. And so I like to think about how music has progressed over the years. You think about music in Mozart or Beethoven's time, or 1600s, 1700s, 1800s. A lot of times music was, if you wanted to hear a piece, you had to hear it at in a noble home, or maybe a concert hall. Maybe your family might have a clavichord at home, but people didn't have a piano like this. The average individual didn't have access to that. But when you look up a piece like Experience, if you plug it in on YouTube, 300 plus videos show up of individuals performing this piece. I've seen videos of people playing it in public. You have chamber orchestra arrangements, at a piano in a recital hall such as this. So it's really cool just to see the accessibility and the spread. So the piece that I'm going to perform for you today is called Elegy for the Arctic. And Einaudi performed this in 2016. You can see he's floating on a barge here, that he is actually floating on a barge in the Arctic Ocean in front of the Wallenbergbreen Glacier in Norway. And during his recording, so the reason why he composed this piece is to bring awareness to global warming and the melting of the glaciers. So when he was playing this in the recording, you can actually see chunks of ice falling into the ocean during his recording, and he had to stop the filming several times because it just got too wavy, he couldn't play. So this piece is part of his 2019 album, 7 Days Walking. Without further ado.
Thank you. Soviet-based composer. And she composes in a wide range of styles, not just piano, but also jazz, sacred music, choral music, band music, etc. This particular collection, Intuitive Journeys, was inspired by her travels to Iceland, which caught my eye because my wife and I also traveled to Iceland a few years ago and really, really appreciated it. Found it very beautiful. So, one of the things I appreciate about contemporary music is the way that contemporary composers draw from different influences and different styles in the past as they create new art, as they find new types of musical expression. So there are two stylistic influences that I see in this piece, which you may find it interesting to learn about before I actually perform the piece. So the first one is Impressionism. And if we have the picture of that painting,
yes,
that'd be great. But if not, that's okay. There it is. Okay, if you don't know, Impressionism came about during the late 1800s. This was the late Romantic period. And so the style of the day was to write these intense, dramatic, emotional, big kind of pieces. And there were a lot of great composers working at this time in that style. Claude Debussy was doing something quite different. He was forging a new path here in the late 1800s. So he was writing music that was much more expansive and atmospheric and picturesque, along the lines of the Impressionists in visual art, similar to this Claude Monet painting on the screen here. So his music is full of lush harmonies, and it would just unfold gently and dramatically, and there are other brilliant composers that followed along in this school of Impressionism. And so we can see some influence here in this piece, Lilac, in the way that it unfolds gently and delicately, the imagery of the lilac flower, and in the way that certain notes and certain chords are allowed to ring together and sound together in ways that seem unconventional, but turn out to be quite beautiful, quite interesting. The other stylistic influence here is minimalism. And Rachel already gave us a nice introduction to minimalism. And so I'm considering specifically the aspect of minimalism having to do with music built on repeated patterns. As we bring up the sheet music for this piece, you may or may not be able to see clearly from this distance, but if you can see, there's a pretty clear pattern repeating from the first measure. E, B, E, A, C sharp. Five notes. We'll call that the motive for this piece. Little group participation. Can you try singing that with me? Let's sing it on La. Ready? Carries through, still carrying through all the way through the first page. Down at the bottom, we get to a spot that looks different, looks new, it looks more dramatic, but if we look at the top five notes, following the top top line of music. It turns out it's still E, B, E, A, C sharp. It's the same five notes. They've just been rearranged using different octaves. Going to the second page. At the top of the second page, it looks like that motif has disappeared. It's just block chords now. But what chords are they? That's a good question. An E chord, a B chord, an E chord, an A chord, and a C sharp chord. So it's still the same motif, just in chord form. I'll play that as well. Okay. From there, we're back to something that looks familiar, our theme. Following through the whole second page and onto the third page. And on the third page, we get to a spot that looks dramatic again, another one of those different looking spots. But now we know to look at the top line of music and we see E, B, E, A, and C sharp. And that carries through, drops down here, climbs up here. Finally, one last different looking spot. We look at the last line of music, and again we see E, B, A, C sharp. Once again, rearranged using different octaves. Just for fun, does anyone want to try singing that one?
Yeah.
There are singers that can do that, but I don't think there are any here tonight. Sure, 2.5 octaves. So then the chords take us through to the ending. Those same chords as we saw previously. So that motif is present in every measure of this piece. That motif fills every measure. Except for the very last measure. It is quite an achievement for a piece to be so consistent in the repetition of one small musical idea without becoming monotonous or even obvious about it. Instead, it becomes beautiful. It draws you into the world of the piece, the atmosphere of the piece, and it draws you along for the journey. So that is the genius of the minimalist influence in this piece. So, now, the full piece, Lilac. Thank you.
discussing a very interesting man named Erik Satie, who I like to think of as a rebellious musical genius. So Erik Satie, he was born in France, in Honfleur. He was born May 17th, 1866, and he lived to 1925. His father, Alfred Satie, was a very studious and steady and hardworking man. In contrast, his uncle, Adrian Satie, was very wild and undisciplined. And actually, he had a nickname called the Seabird. And this is because he had a very fancy and very expensive boat that would just sit in the harbor. And every now and then, he would go on the boat to smoke a cigar. And that was really all he did on the boat. And between his father and his uncle, Erik definitely took after his uncle more. So some early influences in his life. He took some piano lessons from an organist at a local church. And this is really where his love of music started and was cultivated. As I previously mentioned, his uncle also had a very large influence on his life. Spending time with his uncle really created a hatred for convention or authority and rules, really in any manner. It also created a sense of irresponsibility. Actually, Satie dropped out of the Paris Conservatory, a very prestigious music school. Another influence on his life is something called the Rosicrucian Order. Now, Satie joined this in the 1890s, and it was a mix of occultism and other religious practices, such as Jewish mysticism. They believed that their members possessed some sort of secret knowledge passed down by their ancient ancestors. Now, as I mentioned earlier, Satie wasn't a big fan of authority, so when his dislike for rules came to a conflict with the authority of the Rosicrucian order, he decided to leave. As I mentioned, Erik Satie was a very interesting man, and his music is also very interesting. He was what is called an anti-impressionist. And impressionism, in very, very simple terms, impressionism, the melody lacked direct motion. If you think about the art style at that time, it's more broad strokes rather than every minute detail being very clear. As Luke mentioned earlier, impressionism is often associated with Claude Debussy. Ironically, although Satie is an anti-impressionist and Claude Debussy was an impressionist, even besides that difference, they were still great friends for many years. Some of his most famous works are his three piano gigliopedies, which are just very simple and beautiful piano pieces. He also wrote a couple ballets, and he also wrote what is called furniture music. And he was the one who coined this term. Furniture music was just background music. So if you're at a dinner party and someone was playing piano in the background, that would be furniture music. The piece I'm going to play for you tonight is called The Veritab Prelude Flask pour un chien. And this is a piece that he wrote in 1912. Now in French, it's a little bit of a mouthful, but it doesn't seem too crazy. But translated to English, it means genuine flabby preludes for a dog. Now, there are three preludes, and in English they translate to severe reprimand, all alone at home, and playing. Now, this was the first of a set of humorous piano pieces that he wrote. But what makes this piece especially interesting is there is no key signature or time signature. Tonight, I'll be playing the first two preludes, severe reprimand and all alone at home. I hope you enjoy.
Thank you. three fantastic dances by Dmitri Shostakovich. So Dmitri Shostakovich was a Russian, Soviet-era Russian composer and pianist. And he lived from 1906 to 1975, so he was in the 20th century. He started piano when he was 9 years old with his mother as his teacher, and it soon became clear that he was quite gifted and talented at music. So he enrolled in the Petrograd Conservatory when he was 13 years old. So the Petrograd Conservatory is now the St. Petersburg Conservatory in Russia. And he became nationally famous after composing his first symphony, which was when he was 19 years old. And he had a really complicated relationship with the Soviet government throughout all his life. He was denunciated twice for his work during that time because it didn't fit the formalist style that the Soviet government wanted. And he didn't have a lot of musical freedom. He would write pieces for the government, but also write some secret pieces and stash them in the drawer for when times were not so strict. So this was mostly during Stalin's reign, and after Stalin died, he had more musical freedom, and he later published some of the works that he had done before in secret. And later he worked within the government also. So Shostakovich was most famous for his 15 symphonies, his many chamber music, as well as his concerti. He also wrote music for the film and the theater industry as well. So Shostakovich's life was filled with major historical events that happened. So he was in Russia, remember, and during his childhood, maybe like 7 or 8 years old, World War I happened. And that was the first world war that the world has ever known, so it was a very big deal. And so after those years, the Romanov family, which was the Tsar and his family, was assassinated. And the whole government that they have known for the past however many years was thrown down, and Lenin took over with the communist government. So it was a complete government change, which no doubt changed the whole country very, very much, as well as Shostakovich's personal life, for sure. And then after Lenin, Stalin took over, and with his famous Reign of Terror, or infamous, I should say. And this was during the bulk of Shostakovich's career, from his later teen years up until his 40s. And for those of us who are less familiar, Stalin signed like the death order of over 6 million people. And some people calculate that it could be up to 9 million that were directly and indirectly impacted by his reign. And so it was during this time that Shostakovich worked, and a lot of his friends and colleagues and family members were threatened, and some were in prison, so it was a very stressful time. And like I mentioned before, he was also denunciated twice, so he was very fearful of imprisonment or even death during this time. So he worked very hard to keep his head afloat, working on music that the government approved of, the government liked, and yeah. During this time also, World War II happened, and that was a very crazy time for the world and for Russia as well. And then after that, the Cold War started with the United States. So he died during that time frame before the Soviet Union fell. So as you can see, over all his life, he has been in a lot of conflict and wars. So that no doubt impacted the way he wrote his music, the way he thought about life. So the Three Fantastic Dances is the piece that I'll play for you today, and it was written in 1922, before most of all that stuff happened, and it was published in 1923, and it was actually his first published work, and he wrote it when he was just 16 years old, which was really impressive. And he wrote it while he was in the Petrograd Conservatory, and this is a picture of the Petrograd Conservatory, roughly around the time that he was there. And so this piece is very classical and rhythmic, and it consists of three separate dances. So there's a lot of things that we can listen for. For the first one, it's very fast and very fun, and it's full of surprises, so and see if you can listen to any of those. And then for the second one, it's in waltz form, which is usually 3/4 time, and it has a bop-bop rhythm to it, and usually it's one chord per measure. So it's very elegant, it's slower, beautiful melody that comes out, but also immediately contrasted with dissonances that is very characteristic of the 20th century. And then the third piece is played very jokingly and playfully, and so you can listen for a passage that sounds like the bells ringing. So when he first played this piece for his fellow students at the conservatory, they were all amazed at its freshness, originality, and mature mastery. And I hope you guys can enjoy this piece as well.
Thank you.
I'm going to talk with you tonight about Cyril Scott, but first I'd like to talk with you guys for a minute. How many of you guys are here because music's important to you, or it's an important part of your life, or somebody you love, it's an important part of their life? Okay. And that's most everybody that's here. I want to just tell you that it is life. Music is life, and it was life for Cyril Scott. I'm going to show you here in the next few minutes how it bled into every aspect of his life and how it really informed who he is as a person. But that's the same thing for me too, right? So like, I'm a father, a college professor, I'm a medical professional, I like to quilt. I've been able to infuse music through all of those different aspects. I've been able to comfort people when they're dying with music, celebrate with people at weddings, playing for their weddings. We sing and dance around in the kitchen, and I always have something blaring no matter what I'm doing, even if it's quilting. Music is absolutely life, and it's not just one singular, isolated thing that I do in my life. We've been talking about 20th and 21st century composers. I want to show you how these people are part of your life. If I was to ask you something about music, you'd probably say, if I said, name a classical composer, you might say Mozart, you might say Beethoven, you might say Chopin. You're talking about people who composed music in a stylistic period. We have 7 of them listed here: medieval, Renaissance, Baroque, classical, where Beethoven and Mozart come in, romantic period, we can think about the end of Beethoven's life as well as Chopin, but we're hanging out in 1920 and to current day today. These are the classical composers of your time right now. It's synonymous with, if I said something to you along the lines of, what's your favorite Christmas movie? I said Home Alone. Some of you would raise your hand and be like, that's mine, I remember that when I was a kid. Or It's a Wonderful Life, or if you want to go back even further, you can say Chevy Chase, Christmas Vacation, for those of you that were in the 80s. But these composers that my classmates and I have been playing for you, they're the classic composers of your day. We're going to talk about Cyril Scott. He was born in 1879 in England to Henry and Mary Scott. Now, his father was a Greek and a Hebrew scholar. His mom was an amateur pianist, and she was absolutely vital in influencing him and developing the skill that he was gifted with in piano. I don't want to overlook the fact that I've heard a couple of my colleagues say, you know, it was their mom that was important, or someone very early on. And for Scott, it was absolutely his mother. He was so gifted that when he was 12 years old, they sent him to a different country. How many of you guys, I see some kids in here, are around 12 years old. You're around 12. Can you imagine packing up your bags and leaving and going to a different country to study? Well, that's exactly what he did, and he was very good. I'm going to, in a couple minutes, tell you just a little bit about how great he was at the Hoch Conservatory in Germany, because he was one of their finest students at that time. In the late 1890s, when he was about 20 years old, he wrote his first symphony, and in 1909, he wrote his first piano concerto. I thought that was something that I should absolutely highlight, given the fact that we're all in a piano studio here. He toured extensively in Europe, and only about 5 months here in the U.S. The height of his career came in the first 20 years of the 20th century, just before World War I. And then he kind of backed off. I'm going to tell you some of the different things that he did that kind of took over. But first, he had over 400 musical compositions. How many of you guys have heard of Cyril Scott, just by a show of hands? I mean, of course, Dr. Campbell and Dr. Marley absolutely have. Anyone else? All right, that's right. So, I mean, there was 2 or 3 of you. Given the fact that he has such a vast array of compositions here, spanning from operas, ballets, orchestral works, choral works, chamber works, piano solos, and the one that Dr. Marley helped me select was his most noted. In 1905, he wrote Lotus Land. So I'll be playing that for you here, as well as instrumental solos that span from 1901 to almost when he passed away. He was still composing in the 1960s. There's a very specific reason I think many of you haven't heard about him, and we're going to talk about that here in just a second. He was known and dubbed by some of his colleagues as the English Debussy, and really, honestly, that was kind of picked apart by some of his colleagues because it reflects kind of a poorer understanding of Scott and the kind of music that he composed, as well as what Debussy composed. I told you that he was one of the finest students at the Hoch Conservatory. He was selected to be the leader of the Frankfurt group. And this is the reason I think many of us weren't familiar. I wasn't familiar with his works until Dr. Marley said, hey, I think you should play this piece. The principal aim of the Frankfurt group was to stand apart in musical composition, education, in the mainstream conservative British musical establishment.
Everything that he composed was different than that of the mainstream that was going on. And that's why other colleagues dubbed him the father of modern British music. And that actually fits quite a bit better. You'll hear in some of the stuff that I'm playing, Scott's compositions, they didn't resonate with the public. It was too different from at that time. They were like, we're not really sure that we like that. He actually became primarily known as a composer of countless popular songs and short songs and piano pieces. Now, there's something that I want to kind of bring up here, and I'm going to bring it back up here in just a little bit, how I told you music is life for me. It bleeds into all different aspects. While he was studying, he met a pianist, Evelyn Seward, in 1902, and she actually championed and pioneered a lot of his pieces. She would play a lot of his music, but she was a Christian Scientist. That started his interest in metaphysics, Christian Scientology, and the occult. So let's talk about different aspects of his life. He was really interested in alternative medicine. He was really interested in health foods, naturopathy, or treating disease naturally, as well as doing yoga, all forms of yoga, including tantric yoga. It's out there, you can read about it if you're interested. He was an avid writer. He would write pamphlets, and he urged the sick, even those with cancer, trust your diet, improve your health, do alternative medicine. He actually told them to avoid medics and surgeons, which I don't know is anything that we're going to get behind today. But that was part of his lifestyle. He was an alternative cancer treatment advocate, and he actually authored many pamphlets and even two books on the subject. He recommended people consume black molasses and cider vinegar. That was avid when I was looking up about him. Go ahead. The occult. Here's where his alternative medicine, the occult, and his music history all kind of bleed together. He actually was brought up in the Church of England, but he became agnostic. He accepted that as his stance in life. And in 1902, like I said, he met Evelyn Seward. In 1906, after meeting Evelyn Seward, he became interested in theosophy and joined the Theosophical Society of 1914. And if you're like me, you're like, what the heck is that? I'm not sure what that is. It's basically multiple philosophies that bleed together and maintain that you can have a knowledge of God and it can be achieved through spiritual ecstasy, direct intuition, or even special individual relations, communicating in other realms. He also was a member of the London Spiritual Alliance, and he lectured for both the London Spiritual Alliance as well as the Theosophical Society, which he was a member of right up until he died. He actually would go and play music for these groups and people who had like-minded thoughts about the occult, the afterlife, that which isn't seen, which is exactly what the occult means. I wanted to touch on this a little more. That first was kind of a broad overview. Here's where some of these other things kind of bleed right into that. And we don't actually know the degree that he was involved in the occult, only because, like I said, he was an author and he'd write multiple books. He stopped writing using his name. He started writing with surnames and multiple different surnames. And when he started writing, it kind of looked like maybe he was a pupil himself, like just kind of trying to study and see what that was all about. But when someone had read his entire volume of works, by the time they get to the end, he becomes what's called a full-fledged master. In that, it's that he has a following of disciples, he's capable of performing his own miracles. He actually began to experience in mystical states of peace and joy as a result of his exposure to yoga, as well as he wanted to portray those things in his music, he wanted to portray them in his writing, and he wanted to carry them out in his life. And that's what he encouraged people that would listen to him too, like, hey, if you do this yoga, if you take this apple cider vinegar and molasses, we can cure your cancer, type of thing. I mentioned earlier that his mom played a pivotal role in his life. I'll segue here for 2 seconds and just say the people that you surround yourself and the things that you decide to bring into your life absolutely have an influence on your life. I say that especially because my kids are here. I know other kids are here too. Women specifically played a heavy role in his life. He was deeply influenced by a gal named Henrietta Louise Stevenson about love and marriage. It led him to adopt a philosophy in life, which we would now call polyamory now, or you don't necessarily have to be married. He was also influenced by an individual named Nelsa Chaplin, and here's where kind of everything I hope will come full circle for you. Nelson Chaplin and her husband Alex, they had an alternative health resort in England called The Fir. She was a musician, and that was how he became interested, and he became friends with her. However, she would be able to improvise and play the piano and translate states and improvise all types of different music. She was also able to perceive natural spirits and communicate through a language of color or sound. She also was a clairvoyant of sorts. She was able to talk with spirits. And she influenced Scott and told him, "You absolutely have this gift as well." So Scott was informed by her that he was a channel for music of nature, spirits, and the dead. He actually ended up settling down with a gal named Marjorie Hatson, who was a clairvoyant herself who also communicated with the dead. So he would literally, music is what brought him to be able to know these individuals. Their influences bled into his own life. That is his thing with the occult. But like, what do we make of all this? Okay, so it's fine to know all of those different things. First, he has an extensive library. If you want to read all of it, it can be a little bit exciting, even though he was an author of semi-fictional literature. But it actually paralleled and mirrored a lot of his own life. So you actually can understand a little more if you decide to read all those volumes. And then the other thing is that he really truly was a brilliant individual. He had an unusual capacity to literally admire anyone who could teach him something, whether it was musically, spiritually, about his health, whatnot. The only other thing that I'd maybe throw in there is that he was a little credulous at times. And what I mean by that is he maybe didn't critically think through everything and would just grab it and say, yes. So, next slide. He was also an artist. I wanted to show you some of the art that he drew. He was a literary scholar. I already told you that he wrote extensively, but he wrote on prose, alternative medicine, occultism, as well as poetry. And he used colorful titles, like you saw from his art. He did beautiful watercolor paintings. But he would name his titles things like The Shadows of Silence and Songs of Yesterday, blending the occult and his love for music. If we drop down to this last bullet here, he frequently used translations of Chinese poetry as the basis for his compositions. And here's where Lotus Land comes into play. It was his most undoubtedly big hit. He used Asian musical techniques common to modernist composers to represent the exotic East. What I thought was a little interesting is there's a quote that he has online that I should appeal to Eastern taste as curious because I've never been to the East, nor have I heard much Eastern music. However, I can therefore only account for the fact that by his extensive study of Oriental philosophy that he was able to imagine what that would sound like and compose pieces like Lotus Land. You'll see throughout the piece when I play, there are pentatonic contours in there. And for those of you that don't know much about music, I'll just tell you that there are seven semitones that make up a whole scale. If we do a pentatonic contour, we're only going to use five of those, and you'll hear it. It doesn't sound complete. It sounds interesting. I'll play one for you here just at the beginning before I play my piece, you can hear it. And then he fancifully decorated and influenced Chinese stringed instruments, and you'll hear some of that, how he tried to replicate that on the keyboard. You can go to the next slide. I'll play that pentatonic contour for you, and then I will play Lotus Land. It doesn't sound complete, right? All right, here's Lotus Land. Thank you.
composer Kaija Saariaho was born in Helsinki, Finland in October 14, 1952, and passed away in June last year. She's one of the 21st century's greats. In 21st century, music generally became more and more diverse in style, so music is too diverse to categorize or limit. So she composed lots of operas, concertos, choral works, chamber music, and solos, and there are a lot of dissonance and unpredictable rhythms. And she composed only 5 solo compositions for keyboard, and the ballad I will play is one of them. Ballad is a one-movement instrumental piece, usually for piano, with lyrical and dramatic narrative qualities, contained in several themes. In short, ballad is a piece that tells a story. There are 3 sections in this ballad that are distinctive because of their homophony texture. Homophony is a texture in which a singular melody is supported by accompaniment that provides the harmony. So you hear my right hand's melody with left hand's accompaniment. Here's the first section. So it consists of a work that constantly shifts from a complex, multi-layered texture to concentrated single lines and back again. So when I'm playing this piece, I'm imagining that I'm lost in a foggy forest at night. Because it is so complex.